Wallace J. Nichols of the Ocean Conservancy, next on Enviro Close Up. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I'm Carl Grossman. With us is Wallace J. Nichols. He's out at the Bioneers Conference in San Rafael, California. I'm here in New York. Jay, they call him Jay, is a scientist. He's an ocean activist. He's an educator. He's an author. His writing is and his speaking is absolutely amazing. It's a pleasure to be with you, sort of, Jay.
Hey, how you doing, Carl? It's a pleasure to be with you, too.
But one of the remarkable things that you've said is, as goes the oceans, so goes life on planet Earth. Like, what do you mean by that?
Well, I think it's absolutely the case that we live on an ocean planet. You know, we tend to focus our thoughts and our energies around the one-third of the planet that's Earth. But two-thirds of the planet, even 71% of our planet, is covered by ocean. So we are living on an ocean planet. 80% of the biodiversity is in the ocean, and 90% of habitat, available habitat, is oceanic. It's marine. It's salt water. So we are an ocean planet, even though we tend to be dry land biased. We can't get around it, whether we're talking about global warming, just really at its core an ocean warming issue, or we're talking about our atmosphere, or if we're talking about weather, if we're talking about food, natural resources, we have to talk about the ocean. This is an ocean planet. And it's amazing how few people actually realize that. And of course, we're biased as human beings. We're not sea turtles, we're dry land human beings. So, you know, we have this bias towards what's going on the land, on the soil, but we are on an ocean planet.
Let me quote from, but this is a piece that you wrote in the Santa Cruz Sentinel. It's pretty long, but it's frankly brilliant. Our lives are a gift from the ocean, the air in our lungs, the water we drink, our climate and our food supply are all signature gifts of a blue planet. The ocean is what makes this world a shelter for us. We owe much less to the scattering of dry land we tend to think of as the Earth. Our base survival and our greatest dreams all thrive on the generous brew of salt water. Considering that, how do you see the future?
Well, we've got an ocean crisis on our hands, and I don't use the word crisis lightly. Things in our ocean are changing. It's warming. Our weather is changing. The storminess of the ocean is changing. The productivity of the ocean itself, and then our abusiveness towards the ocean is starting to add up. We used to think that the ocean could take all that we put in it and just handle it. And we had this idea that dilution is the solution to pollution. And it was, in fact. And we thought that the ocean could give us limitlessly, bountifully, everything we could ever want to take from it. And it could. And then at some point, we grew in numbers. We've got the internal combustion engine. We started making plastic things. We started inventing chemicals that the ocean's never seen before. And all of those things together have increased our imprint on the ocean, our ocean footprint, if you will. So we've taken much more out of the ocean than it can give. We've put much too much into the ocean than it can handle, than it can decompose. We've put things into the ocean that just don't go away. They persist in the environment, and they come back to us in through the food chain, through the things that we eat. So we've just abused the ocean for far too long, And part of the reason is that we just didn't understand how much we depend on the ocean. So that, it's just stating that and getting the word out there about this situation, I think, is a first step. Once people understand how much we are interconnected with the ocean, even if we're, if you're sitting in Indiana listening to this, you're still dependent on the ocean, whether you can see the ocean or feel it. It's still an ocean planet, and you are on this planet.
How close are we to the point of no return? I mean, you're featured in Leonardo DiCaprio's The 11th Hour. How close to midnight are we in terms of the ocean?
Well, in terms of where are we in, with regard to this crisis, and how much time do we have? You know, that's a really, it's a difficult thing to predict. I mean, things have been happening almost on a weekly or monthly basis lately that surprise me, shock me in a negative way. And at the same time, things are happening almost on a monthly basis that surprise me in a positive way, advances and breakthroughs and successes. So both in the form of new destructive forces and hopeful solutions. That said, there are several species of beautiful marine animals that we hold near and dear, like the leatherback sea turtle, that scientists predict that the Pacific leatherback sea turtle has a decade at current trajectories. With the current ocean environment, the current level of bycatch, the current level of beach development, and all those things, if nothing changes, the leatherback turtle is predicted to be gone from the Pacific in 10 years. 90% of the big animals in the ocean have been removed. Some scientists predict that by 2048, ocean fishing as we know it will be no more. So we're living in this crisis mode, and we're adapting and surviving under conditions that 20 years ago nobody would have wanted to live under. We've got increasing plastic in the ocean. We've got collapsing fisheries. We've got endangered species. The animals that we love are disappearing. So we're adapting to these changes, and we will continue to adapt. And it won't be fun, and it won't be the planet that we would choose to live on unless we're able to turn things around.
We've been talking to Wallace J. Nichols, known as Jay, an ocean scientist and ocean activist. Now, Jay, you were speaking a couple of minutes ago about some good things, some good news. Tell us the good news.
Yeah, in this sea of destruction, as it seems to be, or this ocean crisis, there's lots of good news. There are, literally hundreds of thousands of people around the world have taken up the ocean cause as their main concern. It's what they do day and night. They fight for the ocean. You've got networks, global networks like Surfrider, the Waterkeeper Alliance, and Ocean Revolution, who are working with young people and surfer activists and ocean lovers and people with connection to water around the world and solving problems. And sometimes it's through the heavy-handed things like lawsuits and protests, but sometimes it's through connecting with people, helping them understand the problem, and then seeking a solution together.
Wallace J. Nichols, thanks so much for being with us, and thank you so much for your work. I'm Carl Grossman. This has been Enviro Close Up. To check out the website of Enviro Video, which produces Enviro Close Up, just go on the internet to envirovideo.com. Thank you for watching.